Bruce's situation looked quite frightening. He was having difficulty breathing. Large beads of perspiration were all over his body. He was making some kind of twitching motions. He was unresponsive, and he would be alternatingly flaccid and rigid. His pupils did not react.
What exactly happened to Bruce Lee? Before we get into that, we must first know of the circumstances surrounding Bruce Lee. Bruce Lee, 32 years old, was one of the most revered martial arts practitioners in the world, an advanced student of philosophy, and a charismatic actor whose anticipated film, Enter the Dragon, was a month away from release. The Hong Kong Hollywood joint production of Enter the Dragon, co-starring John Saxon and Jim Kelly, and with a score by Lalo Schifrin, was poised to be a huge hit, and Bruce Lee was determined to parlay it into an entertainment empire. But despite his training regime and a careful diet based on vegetables and fish, Lee had health problems in 1973. On May 10th, he collapsed during a dialogue session for Enter the Dragon, suffering from severe headaches and seizures. He was diagnosed with cerebral edema and was treated and recovered. We take a look at what the doctor treating him at that time has to say regarding his condition.
He had been found collapsed onto the floor, and had either been found unconscious or rapidly became unconscious thereafter, monitoring blood pressure, which then began to decline. Because there was some periodic stiffness of neck and because of his pupillary findings and the suddenness of the onset of illness, we felt pretty confident that something was going on inside the head. He was examined all over, and no other injuries were found, nothing to explain his present situation.
On 20th July 1973, Lee was planning to have dinner in Hong Kong with actor Judge Lazenby, a planned co-star. First, his friend, film producer Raymond Chow, came to the house Lee shared with his wife, Linda, to discuss Game of Death, a film that had begun before Enter the Dragon, which was in the process of resuming. After working for a while, during which Lee was reportedly very animated, Lee and Chow left to drive to the apartment of actress Betty Ting Pei, who was Lee's mistress. Lee complained of a headache at Pei's apartment, and she gave him a common pain prescription drug called Equagesic at about 7 p.m. He decided to rest in her bed. Chow went on ahead to the restaurant where they would dine with Judge Lazenby. Chow called Pei after a while and asked when Lee would join them because it was getting quite late. But when she went into the bedroom, Pei could not revive Lee. After neither Chow nor a doctor Pei summoned could revive Lee, he was finally taken to the hospital and there declared dead at around 11 p.m. Chow had called Lee's wife to come to the hospital. While the shock of Bruce Lee's death rippled around the world, the autopsy Lee's widow requested went forward. A repeat of a cerebral edema was given as the cause. Equagesic and marijuana were both found in his system, and there has been speculation that either may have played a part in his demise. Also, it was a very hot day, and the possibility exists of heat stroke, which may have been worsened because Lee had his sweat glands in his armpits surgically removed. another cause bandied out about was the use of steroids. And now, we will dissect the true cause of Bruce Lee's death using science. Firstly, we will clarify if the use of steroids on Bruce Lee played a role in his death. Bruce Lee had abused steroids over the years for his back injury that he was alleged to have suffered. After the back injury, Lee became a fanatical in training his body to be as strong and as fast as possible because he knew he needed to heal up fast. Everybody gets the idea that anabolic steroids will blow you up with muscle like a bodybuilder. But all anabolic steroids will do is cause your body to heal faster. If you train specifically like a bodybuilder and eat like a bodybuilder, then you gain a lot of muscle mass. But if you train like Bruce Lee did, with an emphasis on pure strength, explosiveness, and speed, then you get a ripped, cheetah-fast body. And that's how and why Bruce Lee looked and moved like he did. Long-term steroid use is associated with heart issues and degenerative joint issues from all the heavy lifting. But steroids don't cause neurological seizures or brain edema. That's something else. In subsequent years, this has led to him using cannabis as pain relief. On May 10th, 1973, Bruce Lee collapsed while dubbing dialogue for Enter the Dragon in a Hong Kong studio. This was a case of heat stroke, as we will explain the reason why as we go along. While his death, some weeks later on July 20th, 1973, was caused by anaphylaxis secondary to the ingestion of a compound medication called Equagesic, which contained meprobamate and aspirin as its main ingredients. The truth of his death related to the fact that he was at his mistress Betty Ting Pei's apartment when he died and that he regularly used cannabis. Professor Donald Teer, the British forensic pathologist, famously stated at the Hong Kong inquest into Bruce's death that the significance of Bruce Lee having used cannabis at the time of his death was about as relevant as Bruce having had a cup of tea. His use of cannabis is a red herring and detracted from the real cause of Bruce's death, which is a medication-induced hypersensitivity reaction. Now, some of you may ask, what about Lee's decision to have his sweat glands from his armpits removed? Was it a fatal mistake? After his death, his fans found out that he had the sweat glands in his armpits removed. This led to various assumptions that were circulating on the fan forums, such as Lee being unable to sweat, or that he was unable to sweat out the toxins in the bad batch of cannabis he had consumed. Sweating to assist in thermoregulation would occur in all the other parts of his body just the same, unless this was overwhelmed due to the extreme heat, lack of airflow, and dehydration that led to his episode of heat stroke in the dubbing room on May 10, 1973. Bruce Lee collapsed while dubbing dialogue for Enter the Dragon in a Hong Kong studio. This was a classic case of heat stroke. This set of environmental parameters and dehydration that existed in the dubbing room are not likely to have matched the parameters, such as ambient temperature, in Betty's apartment on the night of his death, because her apartment had fans and air conditioner and would therefore exclude a second episode of heat stroke. Due to the fact that the cause of death, as determined at autopsy, was cerebral edema, some people felt that Bruce Lee had suffered from cerebral edema when he first collapsed, dubbing his voice in Enter the Dragon, and his subsequent collapse in Betty Tingpin's apartment are also due to the same cause, due to hypothermia or heat stroke. But we have to note that the circumstances were not the same. That is, Bruce was in a comfortable, air-conditioned apartment when he died, and not in a small, stifling dubbing studio that had the air conditioning switch off to minimize background noise. Cerebral edema can occur for a number of reasons and can be associated with a number of syndromes. The environment at the time of his death was not a necessary and sufficient cause of heat stroke. It is believed Bruce Lee suffered an episode of anaphylaxis in response to ingesting the aquagesic medication. This was the view of Professor Donald Thiers, the renowned British forensic pathologist who was called to give an opinion at the inquest into Bruce's death in Hong Kong. Another thing to note, Betty Tingpin's apartment was indeed air-conditioned on that sultry Hong Kong day. The weather records for Hong Kong on July 20th, 1973 noted that it was a very hot and humid day. As per Hong Kong Meteorological Office, pictures were taken of Betty's apartment at the time of Bruce's death, and an air conditioner or fan was clearly visible. Bruce or Betty would not have sat in a sweltering apartment without having a fan or air conditioner turned on. Another issue, it is likely that Bruce was quite dehydrated on the day of his collapse on May 10th during his dubbing in Enter the Dragon, and that this had contributed to his episode of heat stroke. In contrast to this, rather than Bruce being cloistered in a tiny dubbing room with no windows open or air conditioning and without fluids, he was in a spacious apartment with a free flow of air and had been consuming fluids, as evidenced by the police investigation at the time. Therefore, the possibility of heat stroke is less likely in the environment of Betty's apartment. After all, she herself did not become unwell or mention this as an issue at the time. It has been known that Betty Tingpin gave Bruce aquagesic pills multiple times during their relationship. So why were there no allergic reactions prior to July 20? The allergic reaction, or hypersensitivity reaction, or the anaphylaxis episode, however you may wish to call it, is a deep and complex issue. But it boils down to this: anaphylaxis is an unpredictable condition. It can develop even with previous multiple exposures to the causative substance. It is no surprise that Bruce may have been given the same medication previously. Bruce, due to being quite exhausted and stressed at the time of his death, was perhaps more vulnerable to such a reaction. It is the thing that killed him in the end, and life remains full of irony. It was not another human being that killed Bruce. Not a big, strong opponent of flesh and blood, but a little, innocuous tablet. You may ask, why was Bruce quite exhausted and stressed at the time of his death? Bruce, just before his death, had been under enormous pressure. It would appear that his life had become quite chaotic, and in the months leading up to his death, he had narrowly avoided dying through an episode of heat stroke. That was the May 10th incident. He was constantly being challenged to fight by people who wanted to challenge his martial art prowess. He was now under pressure to produce more martial art movies and at risk of being manipulated, conned, leaned on, and extorted by the Chinese and Japanese triads. It was reported that he had been drinking alcohol regularly but couldn't tolerate its effect, and allegations had been made about his drug use. He was certainly using cannabis regularly. He had been suffering from headaches, likely a consequence of the episode on May 10. Betty reported that he was very tired. This was most unusual for this man of apparent boundless energy and dynamism who had been nicknamed Never Sit Still. Bruce had lost a significant amount of weight, and those around him said he was hyper-vigilant and on edge. He was a man heading towards exhaustion. This state of stress and exhaustion was a factor in the anaphylactic or hypersensitivity reaction that led to his death. The next important question to know: is there any history of anaphylaxis among Bruce's family? There is no known history of anaphylaxis among his family, and it would not necessarily be a predictor of whether Bruce was born with or developed a hypersensitivity to certain substances. Betty Tingpei had been somewhat maligned due to her presence with Bruce when he died. All over the world, every day, people are dying from anaphylaxis reactions, even very fit athletes. In the same vein, people are also dying from heat stroke, which nearly killed Bruce 2 months before his actual death. This is still happening, as in the case of the Chinese MMA fighter Yang Jian Bing, who died in the Philippines in 2015 of heat stroke and dehydration before a fight. Bruce either died of a second episode of heat stroke on a hot, humid night in Hong Kong, perhaps overexerting himself in some way, and being physiologically primed and vulnerable to another episode, or he suffered a medication hypersensitivity reaction in the absence of a history of similar episodes, but primed by the stress that he was under. The medical literature does support a greater likelihood of allergic type reactions when an individual is under stress, and this seems principally to be due to the mediation of the hormone histamine, which is released into the bloodstream when one is stressed and is integral to an allergic response. And that's it for today's video. Thank you for watching. Do share this video with your friends who might need it. Thank you, and see you in the next video.